This is my Bible. It is the Word of God and the will of God for my life. I am who the Word says I am. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I'm where the Word says I am. I'm seated right now in the heavenly realms, in the place of authority, dominion, and power. I have what the Word says I have. I can do what the Word says I can do. I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. Today my mind is alert. My spirit is receptive. As I'm taught the Word of God, my life is changed for the better, and I will never be the same again. Amen. You may be seated. If you would, turn in your Bibles to Luke's Gospel, Luke chapter 18, beginning in verse 1. And we're going to deal with the parable this morning. And when we come to parables, it's important to remember that often in the parable, it'll tell us the meaning of the parable. And sometimes people can get into nonsense by getting focused on a particular detail in a parable and not focusing on the main point. And we'll see here this morning that Jesus taught that we should always pray and that we should never give up. And when he taught this, when he shared this parable, he had a question on his mind, and that was this: when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Luke 18, beginning in verse 1, it says, "Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up." So you might say, well, what's this about? What's the meaning? How might I apply this to my life? Well, we find out in verse 1. It'd be very hard to mess this up. Amen. Well, we should always what? Pray and not give up. And far, far too many believers, they only pray when they're in trouble. Far too many believers only pray when something's not going their way and God doesn't hear from them the rest of the time. It doesn't work. Do you know him? Do you spend time with him? For those of you men who are married, this would be like only speaking to your wife when you want sex. Now, what kind of relationship are you going to have? But that's the way a lot of people do God. They don't know him, they don't fellowship with him, they don't spend time with him, they don't talk to him, they don't pray, they don't spend time in the Word. But then a situation arises, then God hears from them. That is the exact opposite of what Jesus taught. That is the exact opposite of what the Gospels teach. That is the exact opposite of the New Testament way. We are to pray and to fellowship with God every single day of our lives. And in here we'll see that we should always what? Pray and not give up, never give up. Verse 2, he said, "In a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared about men." So we have a judge who was an ungodless, wicked unbeliever. He neither feared God nor cared about men. "And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, 'Grant me justice against my adversary.' For some time he refused. But finally he said to himself, 'Even though I don't fear God or care about men, yet because this widow keeps bothering me,'" we could say it this way, "because she is persistent, because she is so persistent, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually wear me out with her coming." And the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says. Verse 7, "Will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly." And I love that. He will see that they get justice and how soon? Quickly. Amen. As a person of faith, that is what your perspective has to be. God is giving me justice. God is bringing me justice. In this situation, God is bringing about justice on my behalf, and he's doing so quickly. You know, you can get online and you can give somebody a one-star Yelp review or Facebook review or Google review, but I've learned something, that if you'll put it in the hands of God, we serve a just judge who can bring about justice unlike what most people have ever seen in their lives. He'll bring about justice for us. And how soon? Quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? So this judge was a wicked, godless man. Maybe you've met a judge like that. He neither feared God nor cared about men. And there was a widow who kept coming. There's a biography I read about a man of God, and it deals a lot with prayer. And he mentioned instances in his life when the Lord brought correction to him. And he tells the story of how once in his life, he was in a town and doing a meeting, and a lady came, and he said in the book that she was the ugliest woman he had ever met. And so when she came, he judged her. But he said, when that woman opened her mouth to pray, her prayer brought the glory of God unlike he had ever seen. This widow was persistent. She kept coming. So if an unjust judge, an evil, wicked man, saw that this woman got justice because of her perseverance, then how much more will our wonderful and good and merciful and gracious Heavenly Father see that we get justice in our lives and quickly? This reminds me of Matthew 7 and verse 11, where Jesus said, "If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more will our Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him?" Amen. How much more? And don't be offended that Jesus called us evil. Amen. This was before he went to the cross, before his righteousness was imputed to us. How much more will the Father give what? Good gifts to those who ask. This reminds me of Luke 11 and verse 13. "If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" How much more? Number one, God is not the unjust judge. Stop seeing God that way. I mean, if you went off of how most Christians talk about God, it explains why a lot of people don't want to get saved. Talking about how God's doing this bad thing and that bad thing and this terrible thing. Turn on Christian radio, talk about how God's given someone cancer. Jesus said in John 10:10 that he has come to give us life, and to give us life how? More abundantly, but that it's the enemy, it's the devil, it's Lucifer, Satan, who has come to do what? To steal and to kill and destroy. Yet you listen to most Christians, they talk about God, the Father, as if he's Lucifer. Stealing, killing, and destroying. When the exact opposite is true. He's wonderful. He's gracious. He's merciful. And even when someone needs judgment, he is slow to judgment, giving them year after year after year after decade to get right, that they might be saved, that they might not spend eternity in hell. God is not the unjust judge. If you see God as your adversary, if you see God like the unjust judge, it will hinder your prayer life. And if we're honest, we'll admit this is something that we've all faced at one point or another. Well, I'm doing my part. The issue must be with God. And things aren't going the way I'd like, so I'm upset at God. I'm frustrated at God. You're not going to get any results heading down that road. I can testify, you're not going to get any results headed down that road. Our help cometh from the Lord. And if we're frustrated with the Lord and upset at the Lord and blaming the Lord, we're not going to get any help. And you go to the Psalms. We see this sometimes in the prayer life of David. Psalm 6 and verse 3, David wrote, "My soul is very troubled. Lord, how long will it be until you save me?" Psalm 13 and verse 1, "Lord, how long must I wait? Will you forget me forever? How long will you turn away from me, your face away from me. Psalm 74 and verse 9, you don't give us miraculous signs anymore. There aren't any prophets left. None of us knows how long that will last. Now you can pray that way, but it's a wrong road to head down. You might say, well, Austin, you know, this is kind of a tough position to take. Well, all the revelation that David had was the first five books of the Bible: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And David lived under the old covenant. He lived in light of the revelation that he had. But we have Genesis through Revelation. We have the new covenant, which is better and superior in every way, with better and superior promises, with a better and superior and perfect high priest. And we have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And so we ought to walk in light of the revelation of the new covenant. There are times, and I'll be reading in the Psalms, and I'll read something like that. And this may offend you. I was nervous the first time I did it. But some phrases like that. And now I'll mark OC for Old Covenant. He is good. He is gracious. He is merciful. And he wants to answer us today. Amen. He wants to move in our lives today. Amen. He is not our adversary. We need to walk in light of the new covenant. We need to walk in light of Paul's revelation about who God is and what he wants to do in our lives. So David prayed the way he prayed because of his level of revelation at that time. Live in light of the new covenant. God is not the unjust judge. Another example of this is the book of Job. It is possible that Job lived before Abraham. You might say, well, then why is it over by Psalms and Proverbs in my Bible and it's not before Abraham? Because it's organized with the wisdom and poetic literature. So it is likely that Job lived even before the Abrahamic covenant. He lived in light of the revelation that he had. And so you have Christians, and the new covenant is available. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is available, but they're walking in light of just the old covenant. They miss it. They miss God's best. Number two, you can't earn answers to your prayers. You cannot earn answers to your prayers. And this goes against our human nature, because you know if you do X, it results in Y. You know that if you work harder, more diligently, more efficiently, more excellently, you'll get a raise, you'll get a bonus, you'll make more money. Amen. Amen. So it is deep within us. And so sometimes we can head down the wrong road of thinking when there's an unanswered prayer or we're frustrated in our prayer life and think that I need to do something in my strength to merit an answer from God. The new covenant, it is based on grace. I give an example with healing. Jesus is the healer. Jesus is the healer. Austin is not. And so when somebody comes with a great request, a great burden, we lift our hands to God and we ask the Lord, who is the healer, Jehovah Rapha, to intervene in their life and circumstances. It is by his might. It is by his power. It is by his grace. And you might say, well, Austin, you don't know about what they've done in their life. You don't know about this or that going on in their life. I have learned it is the grace and it is the mercy of God. You cannot earn answers to your prayers. This is a new covenant reality. Some people take this parable to mean in Luke 18. They interpret this parable to mean that if they harass God enough, like the unjust judge, then God will, he'll answer them to get rid of you. That's wrong. That's wrong thinking. And if you pray that way, you'll make God your adversary and you won't get results. And that kind of thinking and that kind of prayer is contrary to the new covenant. As a child growing up, I knew my father fasted. There would be times that we would say, can we go see this movie? And my mom would tell us, well, your father's on a fast right now. He doesn't want to go to the movie theater. I knew he fasted. In 1982, my father did a 40-day fast because God specifically spoke to him and commanded him to do that. But in the years that followed, my father would start every year with a 40-day fast. And not because God told him to. My father decided, well, that would be a good thing to do, a good way to begin every year. And in 1987, 1 week into his normal annual fast, God said to my father, you've received what you've wanted. You're about to move the church from the hotel to your own property, your own building. So why are you fasting? You're supposed to have faith in my word, not faith in fasting. You're supposed to have faith in my word, not faith in fasting. And sometimes Satan will get us to do things with good intentions that don't yield the spiritual power that we seek. 2 years ago, the Holy Spirit began a work in me, and I began to seek God in fasting and in prayer. But what began as something led by the Holy Spirit over time turned into a work of the flesh. And I even got into wrong thinking. Thinking that was not new covenant thinking. I thought that if I could only fast enough days, then there would be greater results and more power. And then, of course, when I wasn't fasting, if something didn't go the way I thought it should, I wrongly believed that if I had only fasted or had fasted more, then the results might have been different. A question we have to face in our lives is, are we teachable? Are we open to instruction from God and His Word? And are we open to instruction from the Holy Spirit? His power has been made available unto us as Christians under the new covenant. The baptism of the Holy Ghost and the power of God is available unto us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And yes, we do things in our lives like worship and prayer and fasting as led by the Holy Spirit. But if I happen to wake up one morning at 5 a.m. and before I prayed, get a text, it's an emergency, come now, the power of God is still available to turn the situation around even though I have not yet done X, Y, and Z that day. Because I am born again and I have the Holy Spirit. And I have all of heaven backing me. And sometimes Satan, he'll get us distracted or he'll get us doing this and heading down a wrong road of thinking that is actually powerless. And so now when people give me requests, I know, I in my own strength, in my own flesh, cannot earn what they need from God. And so in my life, I have learned simply to believe Him on the basis of His word, to believe Him on the basis of His grace, His mercy, and to say, oh God, on the basis of your word, intervene in their life. Stop trying to do what only God can do. And so I've been learning. The power of God is available to us at all times as Spirit-filled Christians. True power with God is the result of spending time with God in prayer and in His Word. Recently, I told Jessica, I said, why can't young men my age learn from the conclusions that great men of God reached toward the end of their lives? Why do we have to repeat the same mistakes? And I'll tell you why. It's because we don't listen to our elders. In the last few years, my father hit some roadblocks in prayer. And so in just 1 year, he fasted for 40 days, 3 times in 1 year. If you missed math in high school, that's 120 days in 1 year. And you know how many answers he received? Not a single one. And I'm sure he said there were other benefits, but he headed down that road seeking answers, and he said he didn't receive a single answer. Well, I don't know about you, but I can say Austin Lingerfelt is not a dummy. And so if my father has learned something from that, I'm going to, as a young person, I'm going to get my ears open and I'm going to listen and pay attention. I'm going to learn something. Amen. We're supposed to have faith in God's word, not in fasting. And there are benefits to fasting, but too often we approach fasting as a way to earn answers to our prayers. And that simply doesn't work. And maybe you're dry, and maybe you're cold, and maybe you're lukewarm, and maybe prayers are not being answered. So you think, I'm going to skip Chili's today. I'm going to skip TGI Fridays tonight. But maybe, think about, maybe it's because you spend no time with God. Maybe it's because you spend no time in His Word. Maybe it's because the only time you pray is when you need something from God. Maybe it's because you don't walk in holiness before God. And if that's the case, you can skip eating all week and you will not get the answer you seek. Luke 18, verses 6 through 8. Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for His chosen ones who cry out to Him day and night? Will He keep putting them off? I tell you that He will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will He find faith on the earth? So the issue is what? Faith. Faith in what? Faith in God and faith in His Word. And how do you build faith in God and faith in His Word? By opening His Word and reading it. Amen. I'm all for the devotionals you can buy. But at some point in your life, I'm all for reading biographies of great men and women of God. That's great. That's wonderful. We can learn from that. Amen. But sometimes you've just got to open the Word of God for yourself and read it for yourself and find out what it says for yourself so the Holy Spirit of God, He can convict you and He can lead you and He can guide you and He can answer the questions you have from the Word of God. Got to get into it for yourself. Kenneth Hagin, in light of the new covenant. I said in light of the new covenant. He taught living a fasted life and keeping the flesh in check all the time. Amen. This is a discipline. I lost a lot of weight 2 years ago. You know what's harder? Eating the way I should every week, all 52 weeks of the year. Keeping the flesh in check. And if anyone, any man of God I ever met was a master at this, it was T.L. Osborne. It's funny, Kenneth Hagin taught it, but wasn't really a master of keeping the flesh in check, but it was T.L. Osborne that really exemplified living a life keeping the flesh in check. When my father and I would be around him, I mean, he did everything in moderation. He ate in moderation. Explains why he was such a, even at the old age when he went to be with the Lord, he was in good shape, he was healthy. Amen. We've got to take care of our bodies. You read the book In the Cafe by F.F. Bosworth, Christ the Healer, he talks about people healed miraculously by God who still died early, premature deaths because they didn't take care of their bodies. Our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. We're to take care of it. Amen. Smith Wigglesworth, one of the greatest healing evangelists of the 19th century. He would sometimes fast on Saturdays in preparation for Sundays and in praying and seeking God that people would be saved on Sunday. And I've read most of what he wrote, most of what's been published. And on one occasion, he tells the story of how there was an impossible case, a difficult case. And so he sought the Lord in prayer and in fasting for about 3 days to get the answer for how to minister in that particular situation so the man would be healed. But then the answer came and the man was healed. So did he keep fasting? No. He had the answer. The man was healed. And when the answer comes, that's when we rejoice. Amen. And in advance, they rejoiced even before the man was healed, and the power of God hit the room, and the man was perfectly made whole. An impossible case. Well, I'll tell you one thing. Smith Wigglesworth knows more about the healing ministry than I do. Amen. So I'm going to set aside my opinions, and I'm going to listen to what great men and women of God have to say on the matter. Amen. Summerall, Lester Summerall, my father's spiritual leader, he taught that we fast as led by the Spirit of God. Amen. So we don't just do something because everyone else is doing it. And we don't fast to make up for not spending time in God's Word and not spending time in prayer. I mean, there are prisons where there are hunger strikes. Well, revival doesn't break out. Why? It's a work of the flesh. And the Holocaust, the Nazis starved the Jews. Did revival break out? No. Prayer. Time in the Word. And if you head down a wrong road, you let Satan lead you down a wrong road, you'll be doing all these things in your life, but prayer and spending time in the Word. And you'll be even more frustrated seeing God as your adversary when you shouldn't. Number three, we don't persist in prayer because God is our adversary. We persist in prayer to establish our faith in the Word of God. The problem with unanswered prayer is not God. The problem with unanswered prayer is our lack of faith in the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. Amen. By hearing and by hearing the Word of God. You got to spend time in the Word. You got to listen to the Word. In whatever area of your life where faith is lacking, financially, in terms of healing, you've got to turn everything else off and hear what the Word of God says in that area of your life. You can't listen to CNN all week and build up faith in your heart regarding healing. You can't be jamming out to Beyonce on the way to work and have faith rise up in your heart for a miraculous healing. Now, somebody give me a trashy white person to mention so everybody feels like I was fair today. Lady Gaga, yes. No one in the history of the world has been healed or will be healed listening to Lady Gaga. Miley Cyrus, Robin Thicke, whatever. I just wonder why my life lacks the presence of God. Well, you got the presence of something else, but it ain't God. After fasting 40 days, three times in 1 year, my father realized the answer is in John 15 and verse 7. Go to John 15 and verse 7. Jesus said, if you remain in me. Well, if we're going to remain in him, that means there are certain things we cannot do. If we're going to remain in him, that means there are certain people we cannot hang out with. Well, Austin, I'm ministering to them. Really? Is that why they're still not saved? Is that why they're still not filled with the Holy Spirit? You're ministering to them. You know, when Jesus ministered to people, their lives actually changed. When Peter and Paul ministered to people, their lives actually changed. You know, that line may work with your parents, but my father and I are not stupid. By hanging out in sin, you're not ministering to someone. And if you do that, your life will lack power when they come to you for a witnessing opportunity. If you remain in me, and my words remain where? In you. If you remain in me, and if my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given to you. And so for most of us, this is the problem right here. If you're dissatisfied in your prayer life, if you're frustrated in your prayer life, if we remain in who? Jesus in him. And if his words remain in us, we can then ask whatever we wish, and it will be what? Given unto us. Why do we have so much answered prayer? It's because we're full of everything but the Word of God. You ever heard the saying in the culture, you're full of it? Well, many of us, we get full of everything else but the Word of God. And that's why there is little power. That's why there are few answers. That is why we do not see what we desire from the hand of God. We're full of TV, but we're not full of the Word of God. We're full of social media, but we're not full of the Word of God. When my father in the early years, when my father would fast, they would also do word fasts. And what is that? Well, basically from January to Easter, they would only read the Word of God, nothing else but the Word of God. And they would only watch Christian programming. They would only let us as children watch Christian programming, things like the Gospel Bill Show. And he says that he realizes now that much of what they saw God do in those years was the result of that, time with God and time in his Word. I was reminded a week or two ago by the Holy Spirit of a time in my life, a time in the youth group. Aaron will remember it. When heaven touched down. And I never, until my father put this in his notes, I never connected the dots. I still remember it. I still remember the year. I still remember it was a year. And one of the nights of camp meeting, my father asked me to preach, and I preached on faith. And I was whatever, 14, 15 years old. And it was crazy, crazy in faith. And God put on my heart to pray with adults that had not been able to buy a home, that God would supernaturally intervene in their lives, that they would be able to buy a home. Crazy. And it was reading my father's notes, I was reminded by the Lord that in that period of time, 14, 15, 16, no one told me to do this. I just started doing it. I would get up early every morning, and I would spend an hour reading my Bible. And then I would spend at least an hour praying in tongues, praying in the Holy Spirit. You head down that road, God comes. The presence of God comes. The Holy Spirit comes. Things begin to change. Heaven shows up. And then sometimes in the distractions of life, the cares of life, the concerns of life, the busyness of life, Satan, as he wants to get us to a place where we're doing all of these things that lack power, and we're not making time for the things that yield spiritual power, prayer, and time in the Word of God. You read David Wilkerson's story. Great man of God, pastored Times Square Church, New York City, founded Teen Challenge. He was pastoring a little tiny Assembly of God church in Pennsylvania as a young man. Rural community, maybe 100 people on a good day. And he said he would preach about how they believed the full gospel, all the Word of God, when Baptists did it, Presbyterians didn't. But he said there was no one being saved, there was nothing happening. And so God put within him a holy discontent. He said, God, things have got to change. And so God told him to turn off the TV. And then he'd spend his TV time praying and spending time in the Word. And during the days, he pastored a little church, not much to do. During the days, they lived near a forest. So he told his wife, I'm going to go over there to the forest and I'm going to pray and I'm going to spend time with God. And every day, he'd be in that place by a particular tree and he'd pray and spend time with God. And it was weeks after that, he saw a magazine with the pictures of teenagers that had committed a terrible crime in New York City. Crime was out of control, the gangs of New York, and God put it on his heart to go. And in doing that, he eventually started Teen Challenge, which now is all over the United States, all over the world, and has the highest success rate of any organization getting young people free from crack, heroin, every drug addiction you can name, verified by the U.S. government, and they're atheists. And you read his book, The Cross and the Switchblade. How do you get young people set free of heroism? There's only one way, the baptism of the Holy Ghost and the fire of God. Catherine Kuhlman, a great woman of God, used by God miraculously in mighty healings. You read about her and read about her life. She would pray for 8 hours every time before she spoke. And how many rooms and how many places in America today, before the service begins, there's not prayer. There's laughter going on. There's joking going on. There's coarse talk going on. When I was in seminary, a professor told me about how at Oxford, some of the young men, they would actually have a competition to see how drunk they could get on Saturday night and still write their sermons on Sunday morning. That's a long way from John Wesley and Charles Wesley and George Whitefield, who their challenge was to see how much they could pray, how much time could they spend in the Word of God. Why did God use great men and women of God like Kenneth Hagin and T.L. Osborne and Lester Sumrall? It was because of their prayer lives. Kenneth Hagin Jr., he talks about how he, as a young boy, as a teenager, he would wake up in the morning and he would find his father still sitting in his study, fully dressed, suit, tie, his Bible open, having spent all night praying and reading the Word of God and crying out to God. My father was in Lester Sumrall's office and they were talking about something that was going on in the 90s. And Lester Sumrall, he said of Kenneth Hagin, that man has power with God. Time with God, time in the Word of God. Young Yi Cho, you read about him. He would pray for 3 hours every day, and then later in his life, he increased his time to 5 and 6 hours every day. The key to everything is time with God and time in his Word. And you might say, you might hear those examples and think, Austin, I haven't even worked myself up to 10 minutes yet. You have to ask, do I love him and do I want to spend time with him? Do I want to know him? Do I want to draw near to him? Are you talking to God and seeking God because you want this answer, and once you get this answer, he'll never see you or hear from you again? Or do you love him? Do you want to know him? Do you want to walk with him? Do you want to live as one of his children? Do you love him? If you love him, you should want to spend time with him. And you may ask, well, Austin, how can you pray for long periods of time? And there's only one way. It's by praying in the Spirit. Ephesians 5:18 tells us to not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery, but to be filled with the Spirit. And I think a lot of times, us Pentecostal people, us charismatic people, we pat ourselves on the back and say, well, you know, I'm not drunk with wine. Well, great, but that doesn't automatically mean you're full of the Spirit. As my father said, we can get to a place where we're full of everything else but the Spirit of God. We're full of the news. We're full of TV. We're full of entertainment. We're full of what celebrities are doing and saying. But we're not full of God. We're not full of his Word. We're not full of the Spirit of God. The greatest gift that God gave the world was his Son, Jesus Christ. And the greatest gift that God has given the church is the Holy Spirit. And John said that Jesus, he would baptize us with the Holy Spirit and with fire. In the Greek, it actually says he would baptize us with Holy Ghost fire. Jesus told the disciples to wait in Jerusalem until they were clothed with power from on high, a waiting upon the Lord, a seeking of God. And this gift is available to every believer. Peter said, this promise is for you and for your children and all who are far off, for all whom the Lord God will call. And how do we know someone has received this gift? In Acts 10, when Peter was ministering at Cornelius' house, it says, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The Jewish believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. When he fills you, and he fills you with his fire, something new will burst forth from within you. A language of heaven, a language of God, to pray by the Spirit and in the Spirit, to pray the perfect will of God. The Bible calls this speaking in tongues. Jesus told us to avoid vain repetition when we pray. So how can we pray for long periods of time without vain repetition, only in the Spirit? Skipping meals may help you lose weight. It may help your pants fit better. But let me tell you what you really need. Let me tell you what will change your spiritual life and your walk with God: the Holy Ghost and the fire of the Holy Ghost. Are you dry? Are you cold? I do not need to preach some hard message. If you're dry, spiritually dry, you know it. If you're cold, you know it. If you're lukewarm, you know it. You need the Holy Ghost and you need the fire of the Holy Ghost. Do not be drunk on wine. Instead, be full of the Spirit. Too many of us are full of everything but the Spirit. Turn off the TV. Turn off social media. Spend time in God's Word. Spend time in prayer. Pray in the Spirit. Stop taking shortcuts. There are no shortcuts with God. None. There are no shortcuts with God. I want to read you a quote by Samuel Chadwick. He said, "The one concern of the devil is to keep Christians from prayer. He fears nothing from our prayerless studies. He fears nothing from our prayerless work. He fears nothing from our prayerless religion. He laughs at our toil and mocks our wisdom, but Satan trembles when we pray. No man is greater than his prayer life." He went on, there is no power like that of prevailing prayer, of Abraham pleading for Sodom, of Jacob wrestling in the stillness of the night, of Moses standing in the breach, of Hannah intoxicated with sorrow, of David heartbroken, of Jesus sweating drops of blood. Such prayer prevails. It turns ordinary mortals into men of power. It brings the power of God. It brings the fire of God. It brings the reign of God. It brings life because it brings God. There must be a hunger within you. Jesus said, if we ask, we will receive. If we seek, we will find. If we knock, the door will be open to you. But there must be a hunger within you that is deep, where you, the most important thing in the world to you is God and the presence of God. And all you want is God. And you seek God just to have God. You stop seeking God because you want this or that, but you begin to seek God because you want God. And if you will seek God, he will answer you. He will show himself to you. And when you have God and the presence of God, you will have everything you need: salvation, deliverance, healing, blessing, and prosperity. We've got to have, in 2017, we've got to have the attitude of Jacob. Lord, I will spend the night with you, and I will wrestle with you, and I will not let go until you touch me, until you bless me. Some people might think, man, when are they going to calm down? When are they going to let off? When are they going to stop praying on Friday nights? I am not going to stop until the young people of this church and the young adults and the teens and the young people of DFW know what the meaning of the word Pentecost really means. When we say the word revival, we're not talking about great services. We're talking about God coming down. We're talking about heaven touching earth. We're talking about thousands being saved, the community being changed. We're talking about worldly businesses shutting down because no one's coming to do business with them anymore. Everywhere Finney went during the Second Great Awakening, there was a man that went with him that no one knew, but he stayed in the room and he prayed the entire time. Every time Spurgeon went to his pulpit, what most people don't know is that the men of the church, the deacons of the church, there was a place under the stage where the leaders of the church, they went and they prayed while Spurgeon preached. When the first great awakening was birthed in America, Jonathan Edwards, the night before, he and the leaders of the church, they had locked the doors and spent all night in prayer. Years ago, in the 80s, my father recounted to me how in a prayer meeting, God moved upon David Wilkerson, and he went to a map and he pointed to a map of the United States, and God led his finger to Texas, and he said that the fire of God would break out, that it would begin in Texas and sweep the United States of America. My father told me about that a year or two ago, and I was curious, and I wanted to confirm it, so I wrote David Wilkerson's secretary, a precious lady, she's still alive, and I asked her if she could confirm it, and she said she could because she was there. At the end of the 9 a.m. service, my father said that the answer to everything is the teaching of the Word. How does faith come? By hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You might say, well, I'm expecting Austin to pray a certain way at the end of this service, or to pray with me at the end of the service. And today I'm not. Because sometimes we'll deal with a few verses, and then somebody will come forward, and they come forward as if, well, I need a little Holy Spirit in my life. It might do me some good. You cannot receive from God with that attitude. There has got to be a hunger within you, a holy discontent within you, where you hunger from God, you desire to receive from God. There's nothing else in the world you want more than for God to touch you. Please bow your heads. If you're here today, you may not have ever given your life to Jesus by confessing Him and believing upon Him as your Savior. And if that's the case, you are on your way to hell. If you have never given your life to Jesus, if you have never made Him the Lord and Savior of your life, then right now you may not realize it, you may not know it, and so I'm telling you, you're on your way to hell. If you were to die today without God, the moment you die, your spirit, the real you, will leave your body and will go to hell, a place of eternal suffering and eternal torment, separated from God for all eternity. There are no do-overs. There are no second chances. And so I come to you today, and I ask you, do you know God? Have you given your life to Jesus Christ? Have you made Him the Lord and the Savior of your life? Have you repented of your sins? God loves you. And because God loves you, He's made all of this available to you. But you must give Him your life. The thing you've heard about, that you can just pray some prayer, and you've gotten your get out of hell card, but you can live your life like the worldly friends. It's a lie. He gave His life for you. And if you want what God has for you, salvation and healing and deliverance and power, then you must give your life to Him. If you're here today and you say, Austin, I've never done that. but I know I need to. I want to. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ today. I want to be a follower. I want to become a follower of Jesus Christ today. I want to be saved. If that's you, please raise your hand. Raise your hand where I can see it. Thank you. I see the hand. For the sake of the young man who raised his hand, let's pray. But I ask, young man, you repeat after me, you pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I repent of my sin. I give you my life. In times gone by, I've done my own thing. I've gone my own way. I've paid a price for it. But today, I give you my life. I believe that Jesus died for my sins and that you raised him from the dead. Today, I give you my life and I make Jesus my Lord and Savior. Thank you for welcoming me, for receiving me. Thank you for giving me a new life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you raised your hand, maybe you didn't, we want to be a blessing to you. After the service, if you go to guest services, we have a book written by my father for new believers called God's Very Own Child. We want to give it to you, be a blessing to you. You may also not have a Bible. We'd love to bless you with the Bible. And I would encourage you to get one you can read, amen. If it's English, Spanish, get one you can read. You can read every day of your life, amen. You might say, Austin, I'm hungry for God. I want you to pray with me. Not today. There's got to be a hunger deep within you. You've got to begin to seek him. You've got to begin to have a strong desire within you that you want to be full of him. I've done that where people will come forward half-hearted. It doesn't work. Best thing you can do is go home today and get alone with God. The best thing you can do is go home today and open your Bible. Go to Acts chapter 2, open your Bible. Get down on your knees and pray how Jesus taught us to pray. If we, though we are evil, know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more will our Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? You come to the place of hunger. You come to the place of great desire. You get alone. You get alone with God and you say, God, I ask you to give me the Holy Spirit and fire. I'm telling you, heaven will answer you and your life will never be the same. And you'll be given a gift from God to pray. And the kingdom has need of our prayer. Prayer is not just about us praying for whatever's going on in our lives. Amen. We need to get beyond that. There are believers all throughout the world, and the Holy Spirit, he's crying out. Genesis 1 presents the Holy Spirit as hovering over the face of the waters, brooding. Every night, every day, the Holy Spirit, he's looking throughout the earth for believers who will set time aside to be used of him, to pray for the kingdom, to pray for the lost, to pray for what other believers are facing all around the world. You can be used of God. And you might say, well, that's a ministry no one will ever hear about, no one will ever know about. There's no fame with it. There's no fortune associated with it. There's no glory associated with it, human glory. But you'll know one kind of glory, and that is you'll know the glory of God. And Jesus taught that when we do these things in secret, our Heavenly Father rewards us openly. Maybe if you'll head down this road, the needs you've been concerned about, they'll just evaporate out of your life. Amen. Amen.